Welcome students. In this session, I'll be talking to you about the central metabolic pathway which is involved in the metabolism of either carbohydrates, proteins or lipids. This central metabolic pathway, which is something everybody remembers, that is citric acid cycle. What are the other names for this? It is also called as the Krebs cycle. Another TCA cycle, tricarboxylic acid cycle, that the TCA stands for tricarboxylic acid cycle. Why? There in these, the carboxylic acids are tricarboxylics. So hence the name tricarboxylic acid. Remember, it is here, it is all got from pyruvate. By the time glucose forms pyruvate, it is a 3-carbon compound. And pyruvate to acetyl-CoA, again, it is an activated form, you can say. Still, it is a 2-carbon compound, which combines with a 4-carbon compound to form a 6-carbon compound again. So, it is a tricarboxylic acid. There it is having 3 carboxylic acids, TCA cycle. So, let us start with the TCA cycle. Now, what do you know about say, citric acid cycle? Something which you will be knowing is that it occurs in many organisms, including human beings. So, it is also called as Krebs cycle or the TCA cycle. Now, one important feature of the TCA cycle is that it is amphibolic in nature. Minute I say amphibolic, amphi means both, you know, amphibians, you have amphipathic, like that means in both. Bolic means we are talking of anabolism and catabolism. So TCA cycle is not just a catabolic pathway, it is also a anabolic pathway. What do you mean by catabolic? That means it is breaking down and oxidizing and release of energy, you call it catabolic. At the same time, anabolic, where energy is being harnessed to form a macromolecule. Now, certain intermediates of the TCA cycle are involved in the anabolic pathway. Hence, TCA cycle is an amphibolic pathway. So, it has both a catabolic role and an anabolic role. So, what is the catabolic role? It is the final common pathway for the oxidation of carbohydrates, lipids and proteins. We all saw that how carbohydrates are oxidized by glycolysis. If you take glycolysis, glucose forms pyruvate. Pyruvate further forms acetyl-CoA. What is the further fate of acetyl-CoA? It is TCA cycle. You look at lipids. Lipids means triacylglycerol are broken down by lipolysis to form free fatty acids. Free fatty acids go to various tissues. In the various tissues, fatty acids are broken down to form acetyl-CoA by beta oxidation. So what will happen to the acetyl-CoA? It undergoes TCA cycle. What about proteins? Proteins, we have seen already that proteins can be broken down, especially very rarely they are used for energy. They are mainly structural. But if they are used for energy, they are going to form the intermediates of the TCA cycle, and thereby either they are going to get metabolized and give energy, or they are going to form glucose and then give energy, or they are going to form lipids or ketone bodies and thereby give energy. So what is the importance of TCA cycle? It is the final catabolic pathway for carbohydrates, proteins and lipids, the main energy givers within the body. Now, what is its anabolic role? It provides intermediates to what? To for the synthesis of various compounds. I'll be talking in detail about the anabolic role of a TCA cycle, but it is just for example I have given here. It provides intermediates for the synthesis of many compounds like glucose, yes, gluconeogenesis. Amino acids, yes, for the synthesis of non-essential amino acids. Porphyrins, heme, fatty acids, that is cholesterol, fatty acids, everything it provides intermediates which are needed for in the body for the synthesis of these compounds. So let us talk about the sequence of reactions, what is happening in the TCA cycle. Now, I have given out only the list of the different enzymes in the PowerPoint slide, or I'll be talking to you about the different reactions as we go ahead. Do you need to know the cycle? Usually not. So that's why I'm not going into the complete details of the TCA cycle. I am going to talk to you about certain intermediates which are very important in the TCA cycle. So let us start with, first we got from glucose pyruvate. What happens to this pyruvate? Pyruvate can undergo pyruvate dehydrogenase to form acetyl-CoA. Which is this enzyme? Pyruvate dehydrogenase. Please also remember one more reaction of gluconeogenesis, that is pyruvate can form oxaloacetate. Oxaloacetate and the enzyme is pyruvate carboxylase. Pyruvate carboxylase is a biotin dependent carboxylation of pyruvate. It is an energy requiring reaction wherein ATP is also utilized. Now in the first step of the TCA cycle, acetyl CoA is already there, oxaloacetate is already there. These both are going to combine and the enzyme is citrate synthase. Now I have given the list of the enzymes in the PowerPoint. I am using short forms here so that it will be convenient for you to know. So oxaloacetate combines with acetyl CoA. Remember, acetyl CoA is a 2 carbon compound and oxaloacetate is a 4 carbon compound. They both will combine to form citrate. This is the first reaction of the TCA cycle. What happens to citrate? Citrate is converted by the formation of an intermediate also to form isocitrate. There is an intermediate formation, but let us not talk about that cis econitrate that is formed. But whenever we have got an isomerization, it should have been an isomerase. But this is a different thing that is happening and the enzyme is Econitase. Econitase is the enzyme and there is an intermediate that is formed known as econitate. So cis econitate and thereby forms isocitrate. What happens to isocitrate? Isocitrate now undergoes dehydrogenation. The enzyme is isocitrate dehydrogenase. Now there are two isoenzymes of this which are present. One is in the mitochondria and the other is in the cytosol. We remember that this Krebs cycle is happening in the mitochondria, in the mitochondrial matrix. So citrate forms isocitrate dehydrogenase. Now why am I emphasizing this is because again there is an intermediate formation and then isocitrate. Here in this reaction carbon dioxide is lost. This is the first reaction in the TCA cycle where acetyl CoA is having 2 carbons. So one of the carbons has come out as carbon dioxide and again there is synthesis of NADH, isocitrate dehydrogenase, results in the formation of NADH. So I'm just telling you, most of the reactions within the citric acid cycle are all reversible except one. Rest all of them are reversible reactions. So even this is a reversible reaction. So isocitrate dehydrogenase will be acting, results in the release of carbon dioxide and we have the formation of alpha keto glutarate. Alpha KG, alpha keto glutarate. This metabolite is formed. Now in the next step, alpha ketoglutarate undergoes a reaction which is very similar to the PDH reaction. PDH, remember, requires 5 coenzymes, that is thymine, lipoic acid, FAD, NAD, all that are required by pyruvate. Similarly, alpha pyruvate to acetyl CoA pyruvate dehydrogenase. Similar 3 enzyme complex is involved in the conversion of alpha ketoglutarate to succinyl CoA. So in this, what has happened? Again, there is release of carbon dioxide. So two carbon atoms of acetyl CoA are released as here and here. This alpha ketoglutarate, alpha KG dehydrogenase is irreversible reaction. This is the only reaction, MCQ point of view, alpha ketoglutarate dehydrogenase is the only reaction which is irreversible in the whole of the TCA cycle. So when I say dehydrogenase, naturally it will result in the release of NADH. Okay, again NAD plus is converted to NADH plus H plus. So we have one NADH, we have the second NADH that is also come from alpha keto glutarate dehydrogenase. This is a multi-enzyme complex. This is a 3 enzymes are involved in this. It requires vitamin B1, B2 in the form of thiamine, It requires vitamin B2 in the form of FAD. It requires vitamin B3 in the form of nicotinic acid. It requires pantothenic acid because coenzyme A has been added. Please remember, COA has been added, coenzyme A, because succinyl CoA has to form just as acetyl CoA. So CoASH is required. Remember, we also abbreviate the pantothenic acid as CoASH. So coenzyme A is required and it results in the formation of succinyl CoA. Now succinyl CoA, another important reaction that is taking place, is converted into succinate. What has happened? CoA has gone. But what else is important is when this succinyl CoA is converted to succinate, there is a substrate level phosphorylation. This is the one reaction within the TCA cycle where there is synthesis of GTP. A high energy compound GTP is synthesized at the substrate level itself. So this is an important reaction wherein succinyl CoA is converted to succinate. Minute you have got a high energy compound, what will be the name of the enzyme? Succinate thiokinase. It is a succinate thiokinase which converts succinyl CoA to succinate. Now succinate, you might be knowing about all this, is converted to fumarate. Succinate is converted to fumarate. The enzyme is succinate dehydrogenase. Now this is somewhat similar to isosuccetate dehydrogenase, but there is no decarboxylation. Succinate dehydrogenase is an enzyme of the electron transport chain, and the difference is it gives out FADH2. Flavin adenine dinucleotide is what is given. So it requires vitamin B2, FAD. So this is one of the three enzymes in the body which use FAD. So FAD is converted to FADH2. Fumarate is converted to malate. Malate is further converted to oxaloacetate. Again, fumarate to malate is simple. Fumarase, malate to oxaloacetate. Again, it is malate dehydrogenase which results in the release of NADH. Again, it is NAD plus is converted to NADH. So we have so many reactions wherein NADH is formed, wherein GTP is formed, and wherein FADH2 is formed. Remember that there are two isoenzymes of malate dehydrogenase. One is present in the mitochondria and the other is present in the cytosol. This reaction, malate to oxaloacetate, is also one of the reactions that is taking place in the malate aspartate shuttle. It is also involved in gluconeogenesis. When we want to transport oxaloacetate out into the cytosol, oxaloacetate has to be converted to malate, and malate is the one which can be transported out. So malate, aspartate shuttle everywhere, malate dehydrogenase is used. Malate dehydrogenase has got two isoenzymes. Okay, so now if you look at all this, how many NADH are produced? We have one NADH here, we have one NADH here, so 2 plus 1, 3. 3 NADH are produced in the citric acid cycle. Each of these 3 will enter into the electron transport chain. So when all 3 of them enter into the electron transport chain, this NADH, this NADH, this NADH, it results in the release of how many? 3 into 3, 9 ATPs are produced because of NADH. So I'll just write here 9 plus. You have got GTP which is formed, so you will have one more, and you have got one FADH2 which is formed, so that will also contribute to ATPs. So what is the total ATP that is generated from the TCA cycle? 12 ATPs. Please remember, again I have used the term that it is 3 ATPs that are being formed from NADH and 2 ATPs from FADH2. But the newer values say that it is actually 2.5 and 1.5. So that time the total ATPs that are formed will be 10 ATPs. Otherwise it is 12 ATPs. So 9 plus 1 plus 2 is 12 ATPs are generated in one cycle, one molecule of acetyl CoA undergoing complete TCA cycle. So what is the importance about all this cycle is, one, alpha ketoglutarate dehydrogenase is the irreversible reaction that is taking place. Please remember that oxaloacetate is acting like a catalyst. It is regenerated back. Also remember that pyruvate is the one which is forming the precursor for oxaloacetate, and acetyl-CoA is completely oxidized. We cannot say that acetyl-CoA is glucogenic. Why? Because the two carbons of acetyl-CoA are released as carbon dioxide. So in this, water is also formed. The TCA cycle is the final catabolic pathway for acetyl-CoA, because acetyl-CoA is converted into carbon dioxide and water. So this is the importance of the TCA cycle. So let us have a quick look at the different enzymes and what is happening. So as I said, citrate synthase, aconitase, isocitrate dehydrogenase. Please remember, it has got two isoenzymes. Alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase complex, similar to PDH complex, and it requires 5 coenzymes. Succinate thiokinase is the enzyme in which GTP is formed, so substrate level phosphorylation. Succinate dehydrogenase, FADH2 related to, directly to the electron transport chain. Fumarase is just converting fumarate to malate, and malate dehydrogenase, again one more NADH is formed. Isocitrate dehydrogenase is the first step where carbon dioxide is released. Then in the alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase complex, again one more carbon dioxide is released. So this is how the acetyl-CoA is completely degraded by the TCA cycle. So we have a brief look at the energetics. I have already told to you number of ATPs produced per turn of cycle. So here I have given it to you. Isocitrate dehydrogenase, MCQ point of view, remember what is happening out here. Remember that substrate level phosphorylation, so the net value of this is 12 ATPs, but nowadays the newer value is 10 ATPs per turn of cycle. You will have 10 ATPs. So if a choice is given, I think 10 ATPs could be the better choice. Now let us look at the ATPs produced on the complete oxidation of one glucose molecule. We had pyruvate, which is going to undergo full complete oxidation. Remember, from one glucose you get two pyruvates by glycolysis. So just to link the citric acid cycle to glycolysis, let us see what is the total ATPs that are produced on complete oxidation of one glucose molecule. Again, please look at this as just mathematics and doesn't require much of explanation. Remember, aerobic glycolysis, it could be 6 or 8 ATPs depending upon the shuttle that is used. Newer value is different. I am talking of older values. So we get 6 or 8 ATPs. Pyruvate dehydrogenase complex results in the formation of 2 NADH. So 6 ATP. TCA cycle 2 pyruvate. 12 into 2, we have got 24. And so the total moles of ATP per glucose molecule under aerobic condition may be 36 or 38 depending upon the shuttle that is used. But if you use the newer values, it will be 30 or 32. Again, the shuttle is what tells it. Higher shuttle, the higher value is due to malate aspartate shuttle, and the lower value is when the glycerol 3-phosphate shuttle has been used for the transport of NADH into the mitochondria from the cytosol. So these are the ATPs that are produced. Again, MCQ point of view, if they ask numbers, so 36 or 38 or 30 or 32. Let us go ahead with the regulation of the TCA cycle. How is it regulated? When do you think a TCA cycle has to occur? TCA cycle has to occur whenever the energy levels within the cells are low. So what are the indicators of energy level? Most of the time it is AMP or ADP which acts as an indicator. What are the other indicators? NAD plus or NADH. What does NADH mean? NAD plus NADH ratio is actually indicating the redox state of the cell. If NADH is more, what does it mean? TCA cycle need not occur. We have enough energy is present. So all these, the low energy indicators will see to that the TCA cycle is progressing. The high energy indicators will decrease, will say stop to the TCA cycle. So let us look at it. So TCA cycle depends on the rate of utilization of ATP. So high ratio of ATP, that means more of ATP. High ratio of acetyl-CoA means more of acetyl-CoA, or high NADH, which means there is more energy. These all signal to inhibit the cycle. So high ratio of ATP to ADP. All these occur when energy supply is sufficient for the cell. Now, one more important thing is, all the dehydrogenases, that is isocitrate dehydrogenase, alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase, succinate dehydrogenase, malate dehydrogenase, all of them are activated by calcium. Why? In the muscles, whenever the muscle is undergoing strenuous exercise or exercise, calcium is released, and at that time ATP formation is required. So calcium will stimulate all these dehydrogenases and see to that ATP is provided whenever there is increased demand for ATP. So let us look at this. I have given a brief schematic diagram. So here goes PDH complex, remember, is inhibited by again high concentration of ATP, NADH, acetyl-CoA, stimulated by calcium. Again, MCQ point of view, that is why I am giving this. You look at citrate synthase, the first enzyme is inhibited. You look at isocitrate dehydrogenase is again inhibited but stimulated by calcium or ADP. So all the dehydrogenases are regulated in the same way, but the main regulatory enzymes are pyruvate dehydrogenase, citrate synthase, isocitrate dehydrogenase and alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase to some extent. The same signals participate in all this regulation of these regulatory enzymes. So with this, I come to the end of how TCA cycle is happening and how the TCA cycle is regulated.